So just before we start on the gearbox again, you can see the windows in the daylight. Wasn't sure at first, but I quite like them actually. And she seems to be driving well. We had a little bit of trouble with the other wheel bearing on the passenger side, so I adjusted that and it seems all right. Did 20 miles anyway, been fine. The other thing I've got to show you is the breather setup on the transmission, which I'm trialling at the moment, prior to fitting that to the new transmission when it's all built. So here you can see the breather pipe setup. If you'll pardon the camera angle, I can show you a couple of bits and pieces. So that there is the exhaust T that it links into. It's a pneumatic exhaust on that. And the first cover plate is on top of the gearbox, just behind the selectors. So that gives a vent on the gearbox. We've then got this vent for the transfer box and this one for the overdrive. Now the overdrives come with a breather as standard. But I found that with just using that one, the oil would migrate from the gearbox into the transfer box, in turn topping up the overdrive until it churned oil out everywhere. So it was a bit of a messy thing. But I'm hoping that this will try and keep the oil from passing the seals. It's only a small bore pipe, but there's no reason why it should build up pressure if it can vent all the time. So it seems to have done the job. So if it continues to give good results, then we'll fit to the new gearbox when that's done. So we better go and get on with that now. Well, it's been a while since I've done anything on the transfer case. I think, as I said in the video about the sliding windows and seats, we've been moving house, so other priorities have got in the way. Last thing I did on film was to assemble the front output shaft housing and the selector mechanism. So that's ready to fit when the time comes. Something else I did, I think I made some film about it, so if I did, I'll add what I can of it after this. But the bearings in, or the seal rather, and the pinion for the speedo drives fitted. Quite a bit of play there, and I think I might have left out a ball bearing that sits in the end. So I'll have a look at that next. One thing I have done, you'll notice, is drilled an oil hole there, because you can see that the pinion's got very, very hot. It's sort of blue in colour. So I've added that, and hopefully that will help. On the other hand, it might just make it leak horrendously, but it's worth a go. It's one of those things that you can get at without taking the whole thing apart. So the next thing we're going to have a look at is the rear output shaft, and we're going to have a look at the end float on the high gear wheel, which was somewhat excessive due to a worn thrust washer. So I've been waiting for ages to get another one. The part supplies are a little slow sometimes, so we need to clean the wax off that. And we've got a new circlip as well, which is always a good idea. I'll show you in a minute the feeler gauge in there. The intermediate gear, which we can see here, should have 4 to 8 thousandths of an inch running clearance, and it was again excessive, so I've replaced the shims and the thrust washers either side. They're kind of bronze plated affair. So I'll just whack that in there so you can see it's a good fit, and we'll carry on. So there we go, that's a 4 thousandths of an inch feeler gauge in there, and it just gives slight resistance. So we've got a really good running clearance there. I'm doing everything I can to try and make it a nice quiet box, and shimming up seems to be the way to do it. So now we're going to check the end float of the high speed gear wheel. It should be between 6 and 8 thousandths of an inch. So that's the old thrust washer there. I One thing you will thank yourself for is if you get a decent pair of circuit pliers. In fact, I've got a set for this job. It does make it a little bit easier. That's it. Hopefully you can see that. So here we have the high speed gear wheel on the shaft with the new thrust washer and a new circlet. At first I was concerned about there being an excessive amount of play, but then I realised this will actually be pressed up against the casing. So we'll put that thrust washer on there and hold it. So there's a bit of play, you can hear that. But it's 8/1000ths of an inch, which is the higher end of the tolerance, 6 to 8/1000ths clearance, so that is more than acceptable. So I just check the theory's right, and then I'll get it all put together. So the next step is to fit the rear inner race for the roller bearing on the main shaft. Obviously it needs to go that way around, but at the moment it's a little bit tight. So what we'll do, we'll get the blowtorch and we'll just warm that up a bit, and with any luck it should drop right on. Now if you look at the book, it shows this assembly put together with the selector lever removed from the front output shaft, but I wanted to assemble that all as one go. So what I'm going to try and do is put the selector fork for the high and low range in the box before we start. As far as I could see, this side needs to face the side of the box. So obviously I've taken the lock bolt out. It won't pass through that inspection hole complete, so I reckon I'll be able to bring it round down into the box if we push it up there out of the way. At this stage we can now fit the high and low gear wheels onto the rear output shaft. We now fit the thrust washer and circlet we saw earlier. You're going to want a different pair of circlet pliers now compared to the ones I was using earlier. We just make sure that's fully settled, which it is. So the outer race drifted home. You can then install the retaining circlip, for which you need a different pair of circuit claws again. Now we just need to tap home the front bearing brace. We'll put some ore in the outside of it. Just a little tight, so we'll tap it back the other way. That's it, nicely settled now. So you can see how it works. The input from the engine, or from the back of the gearbox, on there. The high gear wheel is free to rotate on the output shaft. It's got these splines here which interlock with the low gear wheel. And then for low range, because that's free to turn on the shaft at a different speed, as you can see. Then getting a high input speed and a low output speed. And I've had to use the worn low gear wheel. The reason being that the new one was actually a slightly larger diameter. Can't believe we didn't spot that, but it wouldn't fit in the box. So had to use this one. Stage now where I can think about fitting the front output shaft housing. So what I've done, I've put this bit of aluminium rod through the selector just to keep it in place, and the idea is that hopefully as the front output shaft pushes that through with its own selector shaft, it should roughly line up and I'll just be able to put it into position. All sounds ever so easy, and I think I've already found a snag. There we go. So we need to get the gasket for that and just make sure I've got everything assembled right and that it's all going to line up, and with a bit of luck and a following wind we might do it. Put some polymer blue on the gasket, stuck it in place, and on the transfer front output casing, bit of oil on all the studs and things just to help it slide together, particularly on there as well, as I've made the front output shaft bush quite a snug fit. The selector fork suspended on this bit of aluminium round, so we'll see if my theory works and fit it all together. So I can't go a lot further with this now. I've got to get some more shims. As you can see, I've tightened up the speedo drive housing. The bearings start to go tight, and there's a fair bit to go yet. So I need to get a few more of those. So you can see the setup for checking the preload on the main shaft, you know, spring balance. It's now time to test the function of the transfer box. Now the bush between the front and the rear output shaft is a bit of a snug fit. Now at the moment we're in high range two-wheel drive because that's locked. I can just show you that the rear output shaft turns independently of the front one. Like I say, it's a bit of a snug fit, but with some use it should free up quite nicely. It's not that tight. So now I'll turn it over and you can see what's actually going on. Right, so this is what it looks like in high range two-wheel drive. So what we can do now in the high range, we can flip this lever. So you've just seen that I could turn the front and rear output shafts independently. If I flip this up, the drive dog has now engaged in there. So they are now locked. So that's in high range four-wheel drive. So I can't reset the locking pin unless I put it into low range. Now in low range, and I can reset the locking pin, so that works fine. But that's now in four-wheel drive anyway. So you can see the high-speed gear turning at a different speed to the low-speed gear. So that's now in four-wheel drive, low range. High input speed, low output speed. And that's back in high range with the lock on, so it's in two-wheel drive. So that all works perfectly well. There we are, we've got to leave it there for today. It's getting quite late. So the next video will be, once I've got the bits and pieces I need, shimming up the speedometer drive housing in the back bearing there, setting the preload on the output shaft, and any final torquing up that needs to be done. I've got a little gadget for locking the drive flanges so I can torque up the nut. There's a few sealing washers and things to add, so we'll see to all of that. Anyway, I hope the video has been of interest, and thank you for watching.